I'm a fellow at Luminous Technologies and also a committer at Apache and member there. So I'm heavily involved both in commercial and open source software development. My Twitter handle is on the slide, so if you want to get in touch, that's the way to do it. And my co-presenter will introduce himself. Paul?
I'm Paul, and I'm working together with Marcel. I'm also the architect at the system we're going to look at today. So I'm basically working on that right now. Besides that, I'm also working on a bunch of open source projects. I'm working on Apache Ace, I'm working on Amdatu, some JBoss related projects. And I do a lot of this kind of talks. Travel a lot. So let's continue. Okay. So the case we're going to look at today is an educational system. And we're just going to show you a little bit what it's about. Not because we just want to show everything it does, because that's not really interesting. We're going to focus on the technology it's using and it's being built on. But just to give you an idea what kind of application it is, I just want to tell you a little bit about what it is. So it's a system that we're using in Dutch high schools, and which is focused on personalized learning. So the problem we are seeing in education is that students, especially in the Netherlands, they're just sitting in a classroom and they're not really learning the best way they could, because everybody's doing the same. They just have to do all the same stuff. And it would be much better if they can actually do the things that's right for their level, right for their interests, right for their learning style. And our system is focused on helping them with that. And besides that, give teachers a lot of control in monitoring students about how they're doing and how learning for them could be improved. So this whole system is based on the concept of profiling and recommendation. So whenever the student is using the system, we're profiling that. So we're basically doing what Google does. Everything you do, we save that. We store that data for later use. And after that, we can look at the student, look how he's performing, and we'll analyze his learning style, and we'll analyze modality preference he has, if he likes video or text, for example. And depending on that, we will adapt the learning and make sure he gets the best experience fit for him. So that way we just try to give a bit better learning experience. If you're going to look a little bit closer at the application, we have some difficult requirements, you could say. First of all, we have to work with different devices. If you're looking at the schools we are working with right now, some of them use iPads. That's okay. We could use some iOS application. But some other schools just want to use desktop applications or laptops. Some other schools use Android devices. And now we're looking at Windows 7, for example. So we have all those different devices that we have to deal with and that we are running on, which, is challenging at least. The other thing that we have to deal with is scalability. There's a lot of students in the school, and they all start working together at the same time with our system, which gives a lot of load on the systems. On the other hand, if school's out, everybody just goes home, and maybe some of them will do some homework, but the load on our system goes down a lot. So we have to deal with that because we don't want to pay for all those servers all the time. One of the other things we have to deal with is that different schools have slightly different requirements. Some schools use different strategies depending learning styles, for example, and other schools will use another way of dealing with that. So we have slightly different versions of our system, and we have to manage that somehow. And the other thing we have to deal with, we're just starting to do this, and we get a lot of feedback, and we have to be able to have a fast feedback loop. So when we get a new request or find bugs, we have to fix them quickly and go back to production in an easy way, although we work with a lot of different schools with a lot of different servers. So these are requirements which are not, that special. I think there are a lot of applications out there that have similar requirements. These are requirements which, make things a little bit more complicated, at least. To just give you an idea, I have some screenshots of how the application looks like. This is a dashboard. It's based on OpenSocial. We will tell a little bit more about it later on. And it's completely built in HTML5. That's the only way that we can make sure that it works on all those different devices that we have to deal with. So this is a picture of an iPad, but it could be just a laptop, for example, or an Android device. So from here, the student has different, let's say, applications that he can open to, for example, start looking at his lessons. So right here you see, biology, it's all in Dutch, but this is biology. And there's a list of learning goals that he should be working on. And the list of learning goals is, dependent on his progress at a particular time. Those pictures that you see at the right top, that's learning objects that a student can open to just start working on some learning content. For example, doing some exercises or some tests. On the other hand, we have teachers who want to monitor students and want to see how students are doing and want to see if their profile is correct for them. They want to see, do they still make progress or should I change something in their profile so they will get different learning materials, for example, to make more progress. And this is a process that is changing all the time. So here we can see how this progress is going for a particular student. And there's a lot of information in there. But this is just an example of the things we can get from the profiling information. So let's take it to Marcel for this.
Exactly. So Paul has quickly introduced this system to you guys, and you probably already see that this is something that's quite new. It's an area that hasn't been thoroughly examined and developed yet. So we're kind of threading into new territory here, building on an application where upfront design doesn't always give you the best results. Because, we try to do that and try to look for people who know everything about this domain and who can tell us exactly what our requirements should be. But those people are hard to find. You're doing something new, so you're sort of inventing things as you go along, and nobody can tell you exactly when you're on the right path or the wrong path. So what does that mean for your software development process and the way you architect your software? The best solution we found was to, process-wise, stay very agile. Use Scrum as a methodology, work in two-week iterations, make sure that every 2 weeks you deliver a new version of the software, get it in the hands of teachers and students as quickly as possible, and just get feedback from them. And we learned a lot, and there's a lot of things that we didn't think of. To name some trivial stuff, we created this nice iPad application, and we had lots of girls complain that the buttons we made were too small for their fingernails to hit the right button. That stuff you don't think of up front, and that's a rather trivial example. Of course, there were a lot more fundamental things that we learned from this experience. But the process has been one of feedback and evolution, taking small steps and keep trying to find the right direction for this application. And we're still doing that today. So how do you do that in your code base? How do you deal with this evolution, with this change? You have to find a way that allows you to change basically any part of your software easily, because there's no really fixed parts of it. Everything you're doing, you might be reevaluating it, refactoring it, and changing it a couple of months or a year from now. So we have to also make sure that in our architecture, we do the right things to stay agile. And part of the solution for that is to apply modularity, which is nothing really new and nothing specific to IT. I mean, modularity is all around us. All the engineering disciplines use it in some form. And it makes a lot of sense for us as well to use it and to make sure that through modularity, we stay agile and we can change our building blocks and tweak them until we're confident that it's really the right solution. So modularity basically gives us a way to isolate changes to make sure that once we're developing and changing one module, these changes don't ripple into other parts of the system. And, well, there's always some influence on other modules because no module will be completely independent of the rest of the system. But at least all these dependencies are well thought out, and it's very predictable. If you want to change something, it's going to be quite easy to do and quite easy to overview, to have an overview of the impact of such a change. And some examples of big things we've changed. I think halfway through the project so far, we changed from using a semantic database to a database MongoDB, which works completely different. And because we had the proper abstractions in all our different modules for dealing with storage and for dealing with doing all kinds of queries on this data, we could easily transition from one system to the other. And we even had a time where we were both using both of these systems next to each other. Some modules were still using the old system, some were already using the new. And I don't think we could have done that as easily without applying modularity and having all these abstractions in our code base. So that has really helped us so far. The other thing we quickly ran into, and Paul has briefly mentioned that already, we're deploying to different schools. And, well, this isn't specific to schools. Probably everybody who's deploying standard applications will run into the issue that even though it's a standard application, it might not really be that standard. You might get customers who demand some small changes and changes that shouldn't be applied to other customers. Might be possible to completely solve that by just adding some configurable options in your code base. But if there are bigger changes, it probably means you need to somehow fork the code base. And that means a lot more maintenance if you have 3, 4, 5 of these forks. So also through modularity, we can try to isolate those changes and maybe create a different implementation for just one or a couple of modules instead of having to fork the whole code base. And that has worked really well for us as well. We have, of course, different requirements from our customers, and we have a couple of modules and a couple of configuration files that are different for them. But in general, we can deal with that, and it doesn't cause too much development overhead for us, testing those and making sure we keep everything up to date there. So, looking a little bit at modularity in practice, how should we do that? What kinds of issues are there to look at? Well, there are a couple of things I want to briefly mention. Obviously, you have to decouple your modules by defining interfaces and make sure you design those interfaces well. That's always a challenge because you're trying to make a system more flexible and allowing alternative implementations of some piece of functionality. And you really have to push yourself hard to not have implementation details leaking into your interfaces. Because if you start to do that, switching from one type of database to a completely different type of database is still not going to work. So that's something you really need to take care of. Another thing is, well, obviously separation of concerns. Make sure that each module does only one thing and doesn't do a couple of things at the same time. That's a very obvious one. And another reason for separating something into modules might be the rate of change. Not everything in your project will evolve at the same speed. If you look at more traditional architectural layers, where you have the database layer at the bottom, then some business logic, and then maybe a user interface. most of the time, from bottom to top, things will change more often if you get more to the top of the application. User interfaces change every couple of years. There's new cool libraries. There's new devices to support. So that stuff keeps changing. Business logic, well, a little bit. Businesses change. Their environments change. Databases don't change that much. But, well, the example I just gave, we switched databases already within a year. So those things can change as well. And that's something to take into account when designing your system and breaking it up into modules.
Yep.
A semantic database is basically a triple store. Are you familiar with that? If not, I'm probably best to.
Yeah.
Okay. We used Sesame for that.
Sesame.
Yeah. Okay. So those are some things you need to take into account when designing a system. So I've been talking a bit about modularity, and I think probably most people who have been designing systems have been applying principles of modularity to their software architecture for a long time already. Where things might not be as modular is at runtime. At least in the past, I've experienced a lot of times that you had an architecture. It was clearly defined, different layers, different modules. So on paper, everything looked great. Just in practice, when you start programming Java, in the end, you're throwing everything together on the class path. And that means that, in theory, you could get all kinds of dependencies in your code base that weren't really in the design. So enforcing modularity also at runtime might be a good way to really make sure that your design on paper matches your design in code. And there are other tools as well that help you with that. Some of you might be familiar with a tool called Structure 101, which can analyze your source code and sort of make a graph of all the dependencies that are in there. And you can even define some rules about what's allowed and what's not allowed. And through that, sort of get a report on how good your code base really is compared to your design. So there's definitely other tools as well. But we've been using OSGI as a modular runtime. And just to give you a very quick overview of that, OSGI really leverages the standard Java jar file as a module. And in that jar file, you can stick obviously lots of classes, other resources. And by default, nothing is shared. So everything that you stick in the module will be only visible to other code that's running in the same module. If you want to share something, you have to make that explicit. And you can do that by sharing at the package level, the Java package level, certain packages. And usually that will be the packages that contain your interfaces. So you only share your interfaces, but not your implementations. And by doing that, and by also importing interfaces that somebody else might have shared, you can be very explicit about what's okay to use for others and what's not. And that enforces your modularity at runtime. So, okay, I've talked about interfaces. That's cool. That's cool as a way to decouple stuff. But if I only have access to an interface and not to the class that actually implements this interface, how do I instantiate it? I still need an instance to talk to in Java in order to invoke methods. I can't just talk to an interface if there's nothing behind it. So we don't do that by just instantiating. That wouldn't work. But instead, we have a service registry, which is sort of the man in the middle, where you can, on the one hand, register services. And if you need them, you can look them up there. So this is just a location where you can find all the available services at that moment in time. And once you have it, you can invoke methods on it. These services are very fast. Method calls are just direct method calls. There's no marshalling going on. So it's really lightweight, and you can really make a lot of fine-grained services that way without impacting performance. So a typical OSGI application might have hundreds of services. That's not an issue. That won't slow anything down. So that's OSGI really, really fast. And I'll hand over to Paul to see how that's being applied in this application.
Yeah, so let's take a look at an example. And we're going to look at several different views of how this application is built. But let's start with just a typical layered architecture. As I told you, all our clients, the devices we work with, we use HTML5. So most of the client-related stuff is all working in HTML5 in the browser on the client itself. The layer under that, and that's the first Java layer, is all RESTful Web Services. So we have our clients directly talking to RESTful Web Services, and that's the step to the Java world. Those RESTful Web Services are OSGI services by themselves, and all our business logic and data access layers, for example, are also all OSGI services. We run on top of Apache Felix, but we could run on any kind of OSGI container, but we use Felix. And for storage, we use Mongo for most of our storage, and for binary file storage, we use Amazon S3 because that's where we run. Then you see on the left, there's also Amdatu. Amdatu is a platform or a framework we are working on. It's all open source. And there we work on OSGI components, which makes it more easy to create cloud-like applications. So we have, for example, support for multi-tenancy. We have support for using MongoDB in an OSGI world. We have support for RESTful Web Services using JAX-RS. All that kind of stuff is in Amdatu, and that's just for everyone free to use. And we'll show some more examples of that later on. If we take a look at how the modules are separated, this is a large overview, which is completely unreadable, but I will zoom into that, of all the modules that we define. These are high-level modules, so there are a lot more bundles on the lowest level than you see here, but this is like high-level modules. And if you zoom in a little bit, these are modules that we have defined that we say these are functionally tied to this application. So this is all educational related bundles or modules. So for example, we have something to provide content. We have something that does the profiling and recommendation for content. We have a profile service where we store the student profiles, etc. So this is all kind of functionally separated modules. On the other hand, we can look at some more technical modules, and this is all part of Amdatu. And here we have, for example, JAX-RS, so support for RESTful Web Services. We have something for MongoDB. We have something to work with blob stores. These are more technical components, but you see this is all just separated. And once again, these are just high-level definitions of modules. And let's take a look how they could look like closer to code. So once again, I have an overview of the layered architecture. We have our user interface, which is all JavaScript. Then we have our REST API. And then we have some other Java OSGI services to go, for example, to the database or to talk to Amazon S3. Each of those blocks you see here are OSGI bundles and are always represented by an OSGI service. So in this case, we have one OSGI bundle that contains the JavaScript just for a small part of our user interface, in this case, just one gadget on the open source dashboard that does something with content. We have one RESTful Web Service endpoint. That's just, once again, an OSGI service in an OSGI bundle, and just does one thing. It's just about doing something with content in this case. And if you have another functional part, like profiles, then we have just, the same layering with the same kind of bundles, but they're all separated of each other. So if we change something on the content, it's just about content. It's not anything other than that. If we zoom in a little bit more, we'll see that our gadget, the thing that runs on the device, Just uses HTML, and we'll use AJAX to communicate with our RESTful web service endpoints. And it's very well possible that one gadget uses several REST endpoints. Because we might want to have something about content, we need to show some content. But to show some content, we might also want to have some information from the user itself. So then we also use a profiling, for example, to store what the user is doing. And remember, all of those are just OCI services, except for the one on the very top. Within a RESTful endpoint, we don't want to have any business logic. And the reason for that is that it's very well possible that one OCI service talks to another OCI service to actually, well, in this case, decide what kind of content to show. To decide what kind of content to show to the user, and that's something the content sequencer is doing, we have to go to the profiling data store to get some information about what the user has been doing before. So we push that kind of functionality down a few layers, implement them as OCI services, and we can both give them back directly as data to our gadgets using REST APIs, or we can communicate to them using Java APIs. All those Java APIs that we have defined for OCI services, we keep them pretty much stable. So of course, we start to build a new one while we start playing with the API to figure out what's the best API for it. But after that, we try keeping them stable. And even when we changed from what Marshall said, from the semantic data store to Mongo, we didn't even have to change the interfaces. And that's one of the really nice things about using OCI services and using modularity this way. You really separate those different concerns. And if we zoom in once more, there's just a very small part of the application. But you see here a few bundles working together. So the content sequencer itself, for example, is an OCI service. And it communicates to other OCI services. But it will not talk to an implementation of a service, but it will just talk to an API. And to make sure that we don't have to update our APIs whenever we change an implementation, because that would break modularity, we package the APIs in separate OCI bundles. We can keep them stable. We never have to update them. And we can just plug in different implementations under there. And it is even more important if you have to have different implementations for different schools, for example. So you see that all those OCI bundles are really very small. There's not a lot in there. We just create a lot of them. And that sounds like a lot of work, but it really isn't. If you have the right tools to do so, this is very easy. It just comes naturally. And to just give you an example of how many bundles you could have in some system. In system we are talking about today, we have 138 bundles in a deployment. And 80 of them are bundles that we created specifically for this application. The other ones are part of either Amdata or Apache Felix or some other kind of framework-related bundles. This number is going up very, very quickly. The 138 is already not correct anymore. We're close to 170 or something at the moment. So every time we add something, well, you will have some new bundles. So, and that's really not a problem. It's easy to manage like this.
Yep. So, well, we're steadily updating the number of bundles. And just to give you a sort of reference, I'm sure you're familiar that the Eclipse IDE is also built on OSGI. I don't know if anybody ever looked inside Eclipse to see how they implement OSGI and how many bundles they have. But we haven't reached the number of bundles they have. That's like 400 or 500 or something like that, depending obviously on the amount of plugins that you install in your IDE. So that's pretty normal for an OSGI project to have that many different bundles. I wanted to shortly focus a little bit more on Amdata, which is sort of the engine on top of which this application is running, and just zoom into some of its features and how we've applied them. And just to give you a brief overview of what's in Amdata, Paul has mentioned some of these already. We have JAX-RS support backed at the moment by mostly Apache Wink, but some other tools as well. We have support for MongoDB, We also have support for Cassandra, for example, which is another NoSQL solution. We support different blob stores, and for that we base our work on what JClouds gives us, which is a nice abstraction on top of many of them. So we try to leverage that. We've implemented a system for transparent multi-tenancy, which is really cool because it allows you to use normal OSGI bundles, and just by redefining their metadata a little bit, make them into multi-tenant aware bundles, which means that not only, for example, in your database can you leverage multi-tenancy, but also in your business logic. For every tenant, for every customer, you can use slightly different business rules if they can still be supported by the same code with different configuration, for example. And that's really cool because you can take a lot of existing bundles and just run them in such a multi-tenant scenario. We've also included options to have search capabilities, and there obviously we're leveraging stuff like Apache Solr, and Paul already mentioned the OpenSocial implementation that we have, which allows us to create all kinds of different gadgets on a dashboard that interact both client-side and server-side with each other, and easily allows us to also incorporate third-party components in the user interface that leverages Apache Shindig. So really the Amdatu project is about leveraging a lot of existing open source projects and making sure that they work well in an OSGI environment. So maybe it's more a project like Red Hat, which is sort of a distribution that collects a lot of existing components. So diving into some of these things a little bit further, modularity in the user interface. This is always tricky because if you take the average user interface toolkit, it might not be that ideal to create modular user interfaces. Just going back in time, there are a lot of web user interfaces that require you to sort of have one XML definition that defines every individual screen, every individual component in your web application. So that's not really helping modularity. So there are some toolkits you can and some toolkits you can't use in such an environment. We've chosen to use OpenSocial gadgets as a way to modularize our user interface. That was a choice that worked well for the application we were building here. Might not be the best choice for all of them because, you end up with gadgets that you have to place on a dashboard. That gives you some constraints as to what kinds of layout you can and cannot support. Sometimes that's okay. Other times you might have to use different paradigms than the desktop with gadgets. But for us, OpenSocial is a very interesting and good fit because not only does it support creating components, user interface components individually, but it also gives us some social features, which to a school environment are very useful because you always have all kinds of groups there, and having these groups interact through these features makes a lot of sense. Another thing I want to briefly zoom into is profiling. Paul already mentioned it. We're basically trying to record every action that a user is doing and every event that he or she is triggering within the system. And we're doing that because we want to use this data to do all kinds of analysis later on. So that creates a lot of data, and we need to deal with that, and we need to be able that we're not just storing it, but that we can also retrieve it in sensible ways later on. So that's a challenge, and that's also a subsystem where Amdatu can help you with some building blocks to create such an environment. And maybe, arguably the heart of the Leren op Maat system is a system for recommending content to students. Paul briefly showed the screenshots that we have where a student can look at some of the next things that he or she can start learning or doing. And really, we have no fixed order for content anymore. It's not like we've digitized some kind of book and there's pages and you always go through them from the first to the last one. No, we really have a system that has lots of individual pieces of content. And based on what we know about a student and based on what we know that he or she should be learning next, we try to find the best pieces of content for this person. So that's an interesting process. We have to know something about the student, know where they are, and maybe also add some influence from the teacher who might be wanting to steer some students in some specific direction. And based on all of that, we can then come up with the next pieces of content. And we use student profiles, we use the profiler for that. And that's a very dynamic system, and that's also a system where we are still learning how to implement that best, because again, that's an area where not everything is set in stone yet. We're still discovering how to do that best. And the next thing, and last for the Andatu side of things for now, is search. And well, this is probably not rocket science. There have been search engines around for a long time now. But it's very important, because a lot of times you will want to look up certain content as a student. You know, you've read something about, I don't know, volcanoes or something, and it has appeared in some lesson that you had weeks ago. You might not be able to find it anymore by browsing through your history. So being able to look up content is very important. Also maybe for teachers who are trying to put together lessons, they want to be able to effectively search through this whole big bowl of content that we have. For that, we leverage Apache Solr, and we've created, again, a small wrapper around that so that we can use that effectively in an OSGI context. And Paul is going to do, well, maybe the last part of Andatu, and a very important one about deployment.
So we have been looking at how we actually built the software and how we leverage modularity mostly to do that in a way that we can evolve, in a fast pace that we have been doing. The other side of the story is, how can you deploy this stuff? Because we have a modular application and it doesn't really make sense to just package everything up again and, throw it in some application container and, hope it keeps on working. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we do deployments, and especially about how are we going to do auto-scaling. So at this moment, we are running in the Amazon cloud, but we could, use any kind of cloud or a private cloud, doesn't really matter. But we're using the Amazon cloud. And what we use is a server cluster per school. It doesn't really make sense for us to put several schools on one server because, it has a heavy load anyway. So we decided we have a cluster of servers for each school. If you look at a school like that, the first thing we will have is a load balancer. A load balancer is hosted by Amazon. And behind that load balancer, we have several servers depending on how many students there are active on that that school. And to make sure this keeps on working and we don't run into all kinds of problems, we make sure that all the instances are stateless. So all the code we write is stateless. Of course, it doesn't mean we don't store data, but all the data we store is either going into a Mongo database, for example, or if it's temporal data, it's going into Memcache. The instance itself and the OSGI services are basically stateless. On the other hand, we use a Mongo cluster. A Mongo cluster is just optimized to do high I/O performance. And all the school clusters are using the same Mongo cluster, but when necessary, you can scale out even more by saying, we make a Mongo cluster per school. But this so far works very well. This is not very well, special. I think there's a lot of applications doing load balancing with stateless web servers. That's not really rocket science. But what about autoscaling? Autoscaling is one of those things that people talked about a lot as a reason why you should go to the cloud. The cloud leverages you or enables you to start servers whenever you want and also stop servers whenever you want. And autoscaling is not just about extremely high loads. Most of the time when people talk about scaling in the cloud, they talk about, well, Twitter and Facebook and everything that have massive amounts of users, and they have to have very large scale. Well, that's the part we have to deal with because we have a lot of students. But on the other hand, those students are not always online. We are just working in the Netherlands at the moment, and students are mostly sleeping at night. So it doesn't really make sense to have our very, big cluster with a lot of servers in it and pay for them during the night. It doesn't really make sense. So we need two things. On one hand, during the daytime, during school hours, we have to deal with very high load because there's really a lot of students. And all those students are working at the same time, so we have a lot of concurrent users. And on the other hand, at some point we have to scale down again because we don't want to pay for something we don't use. And that's something that, well, that might be a downside of the cloud. Servers are actually pretty expensive. If you look at the numbers Amazon, for example, will charge you, or any other cloud provider, they're not cheap. So you don't want to pay for it if you're not using it. So what are we doing? We want auto-scaling. And to do auto-scaling, we have to apply some tricks because we want to make sure that you never go down. We never want to have downtime. Whenever a student tries to log in, he should be able to do so. The problem with Amazon and most of the other cloud providers is that you can't just change the instance type while running a system. You have to shut down a machine and start up a completely new machine to start working again. So we used a small trick for that. We say, well, we use a load balancer for each school. So each school has its own load balancer. Behind that load balancer, there's at least one node active at all time. And that's a node which is just very small. It's a small machine. Well, it doesn't give us a lot of performance, but it makes sure that we are always online. Then when the day starts in the morning and students start to flow into the school and start using the system, we just say, well, let's add some larger machines. And load balancer will automatically pick that up and spread the load to those machines. And of course, the amount of machines and the size of the machines is completely dependent on how many students we expect. But we basically see that, well, in the morning at like 8:30, people start using this stuff. We have a lot of concurrent users. And at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, something like that, well, nobody uses it anymore. And what happens then? At the end of the day, just shut them down again. But we never have any downtime because there's always at least one node active. Right, for deployments, next slide. So I'm getting there. So the question is, okay, this is nice. This is just one of the basic pictures you would expect from someone talking about cloud. You can scale up and you can scale down by enabling and shutting down servers. But how do you actually get your software on there? Because what happens if I start a new instance in the Amazon cloud? How do I get my software on there? What I'm very sure not want to do is, create an image in Amazon Cloud and just, put my software on the image, because if I want to make a small change to my software, I don't want to create a completely new image. That's just, cost a lot of time, cost a lot of storage. I don't want to do that. What we do is use Apache Ace for provisioning. And Apache Ace is a provisioning server, specifically for OSGI. You could theoretically use it for other kinds of software, but it works best with OSGI. And what we do there is say, Ace is our provisioning server. So whenever we have some bundles, we upload those separate bundles, all to Apache Ace. In Apache Ace, we use the user interface or RESTful Web Services to define a distribution from a group of bundles that we have. Bundles are very fine-grained, they're very small, but we group them into a distribution. And we can have several distributions specifically for a school. So school A can use distribution A, school B can use another distribution with slightly different components in them. All our servers on the right side, that are the servers we start up at Amazon. The only thing that runs on the server is just, well, Apache Felix, a plain OSGI container, completely empty. And we just put one extra bundle in there, which is the ACE management agent. The ACE management agent is just an OSGI bundle, which will go back to Apache ACE and say, well, hi, hello, here I am. I'm a target. And please give me some software. So whenever a new server started up, and I will show you how we start them up automatically, it will call back to ACE, register itself, and ACE will say, well, I have some software for you, and we'll just provision all the OSGI bundles to it, and a few seconds later, it will just be started up completely. The other nice thing about this model is that whenever we do a software update, so let's say I change some user interface in some kind of gadget, I don't want to package my complete application with all those 150 bundles, upload them all to just have a small change in the user interface. Doesn't make sense, but that's what most people do. Instead, I just want to update one bundle, just upload that one bundle to Apache ACE, and Apache ACE will make sure that all those servers that should have that bundle will automatically be updated. So I upload it once, and all my servers will be updated a second later, instead of going to all those servers by hand and update those myself. That works very well. If you look at Apache ACE, you will see that those servers on the right side, they're called targets, they don't have to be cloud servers. In this case, they are. But it could be just some devices, or maybe some embedded devices, or some Android devices, or some servers you just start yourself. You have lots of options there. But then we still have the question, okay, so we have Apache ACE and we want to have auto-scaling, but how exactly do we, well, start and stop servers? I'm for sure not going to sit behind my computer at 8:30 in the morning and start 30 servers just to make sure that we can handle the load. That's not going to happen. Instead, I want that to be completely automated. So Amazon has a nice feature for this, which is called auto-scaling. And that's basically just, you have some console commands, and you can basically configure a cluster there. And you can say, well, I want to have a new cluster, and the cluster has a name. The cluster belongs to a load balancer, and I want at least a certain amount of specific machines. So what I do, I say, well, I want to have a cluster with at least one machine, and that's it. The other thing you can do is configure some triggers to start new servers or shut down servers. And that can be, looking at the CPU load of your server, for example. But in our case, it's very simple. At 8:30 in the morning, we want to start servers, and at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, we want to stop servers. It just works like that. So what we configure is, well, at 8:30 in the morning, please give me 5 more servers for a specific school. So this configuration is school specific because, well, the load is school specific. And what happens? The auto-scaling APIs of Amazon that just runs in their cloud will start a new node for me with my own image on it. And the only thing on the image is just, well, the Felix runtime with the ACE management agent in it. It will start up. It will start talking to Apache ACE and say, well, I'm a new node and I'm specifically for this school, because that's some metadata we provide. Apache ACE will give all the OSGI bundles that will be started and will be installed in the Felix runtime, and we'll automatically register ourselves to the load balancer. And voila, we have a new server. And we can do this for 30 servers at a time if we need to. On the other hand, at the end of the day, the auto-scaling functionality of Amazon will just shut down servers, and we will just keep one or two to just make sure we stay alive. This works very well. It just takes me, well, if there's a new school that I have to configure, it takes me about 5 to 10 minutes to set up a load balancer, and, well, that's it. And run the auto-scaling configuration, but that's a few commands on the command line. That's it. So it's a complicated model, but very easy to use. Excuse me. Yes?
When you update the bundle and the
The node keeps polling every few seconds, well, the way you configure it. Yes. And as soon as there's an update, you will just get those bundles pushed to you that you need. Because we have a lot of load. We have more load than it would make sense to put multiple schools on one machine. Sure. Yeah, but this is very easy to manage for us because don't forget that those different schools also have different configurations. So every cluster looks slightly different. There's different components on them. So it's not trivial at all to do to put multiple schools on one machine. And performance-wise, it doesn't really matter because we at least need a certain amount of machines per school anyway. So for other applications, it does make sense. But in our case, well, it didn't really help, although we could do that. Yeah.
Is the NESense entirely available to you? Is there a consensus of multiple servers there? Or
servers do not talk to each other. They talk to ACE, yeah. But the nodes that we have don't talk to each other because.
Is the ACE provisioning server itself highly available? Is it a single point of failure?
At the moment, it is a single point of failure, but you can configure ACE to distribute out all its data to multiple servers as well. So we could set that up to be highly available. Mm-hmm. But for now, for us, we don't make updates every hour or something. And it's not critical for us if the ACE server would be down for a couple of minutes. That wouldn't bring us give us any trouble. But we could set it up that way. And probably once we have a larger number of schools, it will make sense to do that because we've seen in Amazon, I'm sure in other clouds, it happens as well. Sometimes machines just go down, hardware breaks down, and suddenly your machine is gone. So that's something we're going to be doing in the future. Yeah.
And that is instances in Amazon too.
Correct? Yeah. Yeah. Doesn't have to
not
be,
but.
But it is. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Back to you.
Yeah, so up till now we've been talking a lot about architecture and how we've solved problems in our application, but this is also a developer conference and we wanted to show a little bit of code. Some people yesterday might have already been in the session that Paul and Beth gave in the back yesterday morning, a hands-on session on working with OSGI and enterprise applications. So. Sorry about that, but we're going to use the same example and I'll quickly go over that right now. And I wanted to show, based on MongoDB, how you can create code that works with that and all the way up to a REST endpoint. So we use MongoDB in our case because we're doing a lot of REST communication. A lot of our data is in JSON format anyway. And another reason is we need quite complex queries on that data. And Mongo is quite good at querying JSON data and really going into these JSON structures and getting at all the individual fields in there. And well, our profiler generates a lot of data. It tries to record everything all the students are doing, so that can be a lot of data pretty soon. So let's take a look at how you would use MongoDB in an Amdatu project. And all of that starts by configuring a Mongo instance. You have to have Mongo running somewhere or a Mongo cluster running somewhere. And there's a couple of things in your application that you need to configure. So you have an OSGI service that you can talk to Mongo. And this is a XML file there. Not always as readable as they could be, but there's only a couple of things you need to change in there. You need to define your database name, username, password, and one or more machines that are running your Mongo database. And when you have that set up, you end up with an OSGI service that you can talk to interact with Mongo. And this is an example of yesterday where we created a conference agenda. So we have an agenda service running. And this service is using Mongo as its storage mechanism.
Sorry, one question.
Yep.
The XML file, is it in the same jar as the Mammoth?
The XML file is actually also an artifact which we provision to our system. So ACE provisions all the different bundles, so the modules containing the software. And we have different artifacts that contain the configuration for a system. And we can have many small files, so each part has different configuration. We can also merge all of them into one big configuration for a school. Yep. ACE will also manage different versions. So if you have a new version of a bundle and you release that to production, you can upload it to ACE and set up ACE in such a way that it will automatically update every target, every server that needs to run this bundle. You don't. Yeah, yeah, it keeps track of that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We have a bundle for the client APIs for Mongo. Mongo itself, we don't provide as a bundle. We could wrap it, but it's not Java code, so the only thing we could do wrap this native code in some bundle and launch it in a separate process. We actually have some components to launch native processes in general, so you could take that and use that to also package Mongo and send it to a server if you want. But I think we've set up Mongo, but
yeah,
you know,
but we just installed Mongo as a cluster by hand, because it's just a one-shot deal. We just have to build it once, so it's not part of the provisioning.
For all your schools, or one per school?
At the moment, one cluster for all the schools, but we can just as easily take it per school or per set of schools. Doesn't really matter.
Yep.
I think we're almost out of time, so I think it's a good idea to take the next questions offline and just try to wrap up.
Yeah, I'll quickly go through the rest of the example. So I was talking about creating a component that talks to this MongoDB service. This is a bit of code to set up that component and to define its dependency on this MongoDB service. And then actually using MongoDB looks somewhat like this. We use dependency injection, so our component just gets injected a MongoDB service. We invoke getDB, and then we get a collection of conferences in this case. We then leverage a mechanism in Jackson to create a type-safe collection, and then we can just iterate over the results and return them to the user or whatever component wants them. Saving new conferences, adding them to Mongo looks like this. It's a little bit similar. Again, talk to the database and then wrap your new conference and save that one. So that's pretty easy as well. Turning things into REST services looks somewhat like this. If you've done JAX-RS, this is really nothing new. This is just standard JAX-RS stuff. And we're just talking again to the agenda service here to get the conferences or to print one, etc. So that's a little bit to give you a feeling of how to develop code based on these components. So to wrap it up, how does this fit with other applications? I think in our experience so far, there's many modern web applications where these components make a lot of sense and give you a lot of leverage, saving you from having to do too much plumbing yourself. OSGI for a long time has had a big disadvantage in the tooling area. It wasn't always easy to create OSGI applications. That has changed over the years. We're at the moment big fans of a plugin called BND Tools, which unfortunately is only available for Eclipse at the moment. We would love to have that ported to other IDEs as well. But it's a really productive environment. It gives you really quick turnaround. And That's BND tools. I'll get to that. I have a slide with a link, etc. So that's cool. And the stuff that we've shown you is all running in a cloud, but that doesn't have to be. You can use that on normal servers or desktops or even devices as well. That's all the same. Just to give you a link to the Amdatu project, in case you're interested, we have a website. It's open source, so you can get involved. And if you're interested, please do. Just give us feedback on what you find there. We have some tutorials. We have some videos. So just look at those and see if you like what you see, and give us some feedback on that. There's one plug I wanted to do for a talk of a colleague of ours on Thursday. Mark and Hans, in this same room, are actually going to give a talk about enterprise search in action, which will focus a lot more on search components and doing some really nice stuff with that. So if you're interested in that, please go to that session. And finally, we have a couple of links for you to share. If you want to learn more about ACE or the Amdatu project or this Eclipse OSGI plugin, there's some links here. And if you want to learn more about our company or learn some Dutch, that's the last link. We have an English version, so you can try and figure out what's being said there. So, we want to thank you for your attention. Yeah. Maybe answer a question or two if we have some time.
If you go to the Amdatu.org website, there's a lot of videos there, which builds up a complete tutorial, basically, and documentation of all the stuff that should get you started. So, yeah.
Three.
He has one over there. For you.
Who's he?
The guy in the red shirt, just bottle rim.
Yeah.
Yes.
There is a specific reason I'm a Felix committer. So, but in general, any OSGI framework could run this code, and we've run it on other frameworks as well. That would work just as fine. Exactly. Yeah. Ooh, any memcache?
I didn't completely hear you. I heard something about memcache. What client I use? I will look it up for you. Please. We package that in OSGI, again, using or in Amdatu as OSGI services. So that's why I'm not exactly sure anymore. But yeah. Yeah.
Oh, so we just download Amdatu, we'll find we can figure that out. So.
Yeah,
exactly. Good. Explaining how that works probably going to take me more than two sentences, so let's take that one offline and I'll be available.
So you mentioned that ACE can have things under the bundles in them, so you can put XML files and other things, so can be version similarly?
Yep.
Those can change often then?
If you want, yep.
What HTML5 framework do you use on the client side?
Backbone mostly. Backbone. Yes.
Ah,
but
what about the user interface?
It's all HTML5 with Backbone. Just that's it. Yeah.
Yeah.
We have some libraries for touch in it. Sorry, yeah. We have some libraries for touch in that, but I'm not even completely sure because we have some interaction designer guys doing a great job there. So
we're not that good at JavaScript, to be honest. Yeah?
The configuration of the app and the schools, is it manual or do you use something like Zookeeper?
For the cluster configuration?
For the cluster configuration and the school configuration, you said that schools have different configurations?
Yeah,
right.
We create that manually.
Yes, but the component configuration is in Apache ACE. So which bundles should go where and which configuration files should go where. That's an Apache Ace. And the cluster configuration, that's just three commands on the command line using the Amazon API. So we don't really need Zookeeper in our case.
And somebody in the back has been doing this for a while. So I guess that's it for us for today. Thank you.